You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. This is the live broadcast garden show from Cal State Dominguez Hills. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the garden show where we talk about everything about gardens and plants, from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. Today's lecture will be primarily on how to prune trees, both shade trees and fruit trees. We'll talk about a lot of stuff about trees today. We like to start our show off with upcoming events, something that you can put on your calendar. Go out to a garden or some type of gardening event and learn something about gardening in Southern California or the whole state, all of California, for really for that matter. So at Descanso Gardens, we've got the Experience a Walk in a Japanese-style garden and tea house. That will be on February 4th. And you can give them a call and let them know you're coming. That should be a lot of fun. Of course, Descanso Gardens is one of the wonderful botanical gardens we have in Southern California. Also, Garden Talks with Lily Singer occur really every Thursday, so February 6th. And she has different speakers who come every week and talk about different aspects about gardening. They talk about various plant materials, how to take care of your garden. So if you've got the Thursday morning free, drop by and enjoy Lily's series. You can buy the whole series or you can pay for each one separately. So last week we were talking about fungi and how to identify mushrooms and the role fungi play in your garden, either as pathogens causing disease on plants such as powdery mildew or rust diseases or root rot. We also talked about mycorrhizal fungi. Those are beneficial fungi that infect the roots of plants and grow out in the soil and absorb nutrients and give them to the plant. The plant, in turn, feeds the fungus the sugars it makes in its leaves. And then saprophytic fungi that decompose leaves and twigs and trunk, organic matter and recycle nutrients into the soil and into the environment. But I was out yesterday actually trimming a tree. I don't really trim trees very often, but I was trimming a tree with a crew. And this particular tree had this conch growing on it. I wanted to share this conch with you. This is, now when we talked last week, we talked about fleshy fungi, mushrooms. The mushrooms come up and decompose rapidly within a few days. They're soft and fleshy. There's another group of fungi that fruit off of wood primarily. And let me just move this out of the way a little bit. We'll talk about that flower in a minute. But this is a conch or a shelf fungus that grows off the side of the tree. So here's the trunk and here it is growing off the side of the tree. And these indicate heart rot or decay in the branch or the trunk. This one here is in the genus Phalaenus, a common heart rot causing genus. I haven't bothered to key it out to species, and I may do that during the week in my lab. So this is what we call a polypore. If I flip it over and show you the opposite side, you can see that it doesn't have gills. And if you were to be able to look very closely, you'd see it's poroid. There's little tiny pores. In fact, they're extremely small in this genus. And I took this off of a branch, a fairly large branch, on a silver maple. And what it means is that that branch is pretty much hollow and has a very good chance of just falling off the tree. So anytime you see these conchs or shelf fungi growing off the sides of trees, it indicates a heart rot or in probably a hollow trunk or a hollow branch. And so it is a cause for concern in that that branch or the whole tree may fail and fall over because of the decay in the trunk. And it's opportune to talk about decay because we're going to talk about pruning trees today. And a lot of the guidelines for pruning trees have to do with preventing decay or preventing accelerating the decay that may be already in a tree Some trees are very prone to decay, others don't decay very much, or tend to be much more resistant to the decay fungi that get into the trunks and in the large scaffolds. Silver maples, which I took this particular conch off of, are very prone to decay. Carob trees are prone to decay. Some of the oaks, the coast live oak gets a lot of decay, usually in age, not when they're young, but once they hit 75 to 100 years old, it's not unusual to see either. Well, I don't usually see Phalaenus on the oaks, I see Ganoderma, and we showed you Ganoderma last week. So a lot of people may not know what that is growing off the side of the tree. It's actually the sexual reproductive structure. The conch or the shelf fungus is a sexual reproductive structure equivalent to a mushroom or, on a flowering plant, a flower. It's not the actual vegetative body of the fungus. That's inside the tree, or decaying the middle of the tree. So I wanted to share that with you. What it really meant in this particular instance is that branch needs to be removed from that tree. It's rather a large branch leaning towards the house. It could just fall over and hit the house. It probably wouldn't cause too much damage, but it would do some damage, and you want to prevent that if you can. Now, I like to have a mystery genus that people can call in and guess what our mystery plant or genus is. Sometimes I'll do just a species, but today I'm going to do a genus. And here are several different members of this genus. Let me just tip this over and show it to you right there, or maybe pull this back and tip that over and show it to you. These are very succulent. They do quite well in Southern California in dry or low water use landscapes. I want to try and emphasize that. This is a different species right here. And let me just pull one more out here. Here's another one. Tip it over and show you the head. Now, these do bloom. They have a big yellow inflorescence that comes up in spring and summer. And I didn't notice this until just now. I don't know if we can come in a little closer. Some of these succulents are prone to mealybug, and this has mealybug on it right here. It's got these little white fluffy stuff. A lot of people call me, call my lab during the week and want to know what the fungus is that's growing on their houseplants. And they say it's white and fluffy. And in fact, it's probably a mealybug. You see this white little fluffy stuff right in here? Pull this leaf off. There it is. You see how it kind of stuck? This is mealybug. Let me move this leaf out of the way. You see this white stuff right in here? That's mealybug. Now, they can kind of really damage plants if you don't control them. And I'm going to show you some more mealybug here in a second, because there's a lot of different species of mealybugs. There's a citrus mealybug, there's a two-tailed mealybug, but there's actually a lot of them. And they're soft-bodied, sucking insects that can damage plant material, especially if they reach high populations, they get really thick on the plant. They can be big problems in house plants and some very specific types of plants. So anyway, this is our mystery genus today. And I'll tell you, I don't want to give away too much. But I'll just move a few of them over here, and move a few of them over here. And if you can call up and give us a guess what our mystery genus is, then you'll get a gold star for today. Now, I want to share with you a couple things that are blooming in my garden or in my home. These are Phalaenopsis orchids, and I repotted these not long ago. And when I repotted them, boy, they just popped with new buds and flowers. This is one of the easiest of all the orchids to grow. A sunny window, usually an eastern window, would be very nice. They don't need a whole lot of light. They will burn in the sun. You can't grow them outdoors during the winter. It's too cold. They don't like anything really below 55 degrees. But you don't really need a greenhouse for them so much. And they're inexpensive, and they're all over the place. And they come in a lot of varieties of colors. They can come in whites. They come striped. These are, pinks or this is one that has a little smaller bloom to it. It's a nice large bloom. And I don't know, it's probably not going to be able to see it, but there's actually mealybug starting to get on the buds. And they are really prone to mealybug on their flowers. This one right here, if I can show it to you, has the mealybug right here at the back of this bud, this terminal bud. And the mealybug will get really heavy on the flowers. And so what I usually do is I either wash it off with a strong stream of water in my kitchen sink and the spray head, or I'll maybe put a little soapy water on it. So a little soapy water is, you know, will kill mealybugs quite easily. But you got to get on it right away, especially if they're on the buds, because they will damage the buds when they're developing and kind of ruin your flowers. This one here is another Phalaenopsis. This one has two spikes and the flowers haven't opened yet. It'll be a white almost certainly. I don't have a tag. A lot of times when you buy these in the supermarket or if you buy them, they may not have a tag telling you the named cultivar, the cultivated variety. If they do have that, try and keep it. But I just wanted to show you, you know, here's the bud stage. You can, if you want to keep them straight, you know, this one's coming off a little bit of an angle, you can put a little bamboo stick in here and tie it off and get it straighter. And of course, people who show their orchids, you know, that's very important. Now, I have one other orchid here I want to show you. That was Phalaenopsis, the moth orchid. This is Dendrobium. A lot of the Dendrobiums are really greenhouse orchids. This one's been doing pretty good for me. I got these really inexpensively because the flowers were spent, and so the nursery didn't really want them anymore. So they sold them real cheap, and I repotted them. In fact, the story of these orchids really is that once I repotted them, bam, they sent up some new growth, and then they flowered like crazy. Now, Dendrobium is the pansy orchid. You can see they kind of look a little like a pansy. And there are deciduous dendrobiums that flower when all the leaves are gone. This one's not deciduous. And this one flowers right here. Now, here's this clip right here that comes with it. And what you can do is use this little stake, stuff it in there. It doesn't want to go in right there. There we go. And then hold it up against it and put that on it, and it holds it a little stronger. So you do want to stake your new flower spikes or the cane itself. Dendrobiums grow by these canes. They get tall, and some dendrobiums get quite tall. So dendrobiums are nice. We'll talk more about orchids in another show, but they're blooming right now, so I wanted to bring them in and share them with you. Let me just set this one to the side so I don't break my flowers. In fact, that's probably the biggest danger for me, for my orchids. I grow a lot of these in my greenhouse window over my kitchen sink. It gets a lot of light. Is when I'm handling them, I often can break off the flower spike. So I try and be real careful. And here's our mystery plant. Give us a call if you know what it is. So what else do we got to talk about? Well, let's talk about pruning trees. And you can see our number there. It's 1-800-339-1193. Give us a call. If you haven't watched the show before, I'm a plant pathologist and a certified arborist and an agricultural pest control advisor. I worked at the Huntington as a curator for the Camellia Collection. I worked at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. And right now, my full-time position is a senior biologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, where I am a plant pathologist and I run a plant diagnostic clinic. If you got a problem with a tree, if you got a problem with your turf, whatever it is, shrubs, fruit trees, give me a call and perhaps I'll be able to assist you with how to deal with that problem. So anyway, we want to talk about tree pruning, and a lot of the tree pruning that goes on in Southern California is done in the winter, especially on deciduous trees. I always believe, and what I learned early when I took a borer culture at Cal Poly Pomona a long time ago, is that it is best to prune trees when they're dormant. So you have to know the dormancy of the species you're dealing with. Most of our trees are dormant in the winter. So the winter is your best time to prune in general. There's a lot of reasons for that. In addition to being dormant, often there's few of the pest insects flying out in the environment. And so that's good because sometimes they will be attracted to trees that are under stress. And if you prune wrong, you may stress your tree. And then the sun isn't all that hot. The sun coming in and burning the bark is an important issue for a lot of species, not so much on the deciduous trees, but particularly on things like avocado and fruit trees, but almost any tree can get the bark burned if it's out in the full sun in the summer months. So that's important. So let's start with the guidelines. Because people break these guidelines because they don't know them. That must be it. No one really knows. Most average homeowners don't know how to prune shade trees, large shade trees, or fruit trees for that matter. Number one, prune to enhance the natural form of the tree. Number two, do not remove more than 25% of the greenwood in a single pruning. The old rule, not that long ago actually, was a third, 33%. It was reduced to a quarter by various tree professionals and organizations that got together and discussed that. So, and prune to enhance the natural form, do not remove more than 25% of the greenwood in a single pruning. Avoid wounds over 2 inches. Do not top trees. Do not wound the trunk. If you follow those 5 guidelines, you'll probably do a pretty good job. So let's take a look at some very important aspects of tree pruning. Let's bring up our first picture and take a look at the bark branch ridge. Now this is important because when you're pruning a tree, there are 2 kinds of cuts you can make. You can make heading cuts and you can make thinning cuts. A heading cut is when you cut a branch back to a side branch. A thinning cut is when you remove the branch at its point of origin. When you remove a branch at its point of origin, you want to make sure you don't wound the trunk. So there's this swollen area right here. And this is called the branch collar or the branch bark ridge. When you're removing this supposedly is a dead branch, and you want to remove it, you want to make sure you don't flush cut it like this, because this leaves a much larger wound than if you cut it like this and you get a smaller wound. Not only that, but this is trunk wood and this is branch wood, and there is an important difference. So you're going to want to make your final cut right there. You'll have a smaller wound and you won't wound the trunk. Now sometimes this swelling isn't quite so obvious. Sometimes it's just a little ridge right here in the middle. So let's take a look at our next picture, which is a liquid amber styracifluia, or the sweet gum, and bring that up full screen. And on liquid ambers, you can clearly see where the ridge is, or the collar. And it's right here, right there. That is it. And if you're going to remove this branch, and you always want a good reason to remove a branch, you're going to make your final cut right there, not right here. You can see how much larger the wound would be if you cut it flush to the trunk. And that was an old practice some time ago to go ahead and do that, but it is now a very poor pruning practice. And let's take a look at our next picture, number 3. And this shows you what happens if the branches are removed properly. You end up with a smaller wound that calluses over. You get this growth from the vascular cambium, and it causes this callus tissue to form and seal up that wound. And so that's what you want it to do, and that indicates a healthier tree. Now let's talk a little bit more about thinning cuts and heading cuts. Let's look at number 4, our fourth picture, and bring that up. And you can see here in the blue that these branches are being removed at their point of origin. And so the cuts are being made right here, but they're removing the entire branch. That's called a thinning cut. You want to, when pruning trees, try and do mostly thinning cuts. Heading cuts are when you cut a branch back. And let's look at our next picture, number 5. And you'll see, of course, here are the power lines. And the power companies like Edison are required to keep the branches of trees out of the power lines because the power lines can arc and set the tree on fire. But here you've cut this off, and this is actually right here, a thinning cut, if you ask me, right there. But that's a heading cut. This is clearly a heading cut because you're cutting it back and you're cutting it back to a side branch. And so why do you want to avoid heading cuts? You want to avoid heading cuts because the first response to pruning is rapid new growth. And you should always remember that. First response to pruning is rapid new growth. So what happens when you make heading cuts? Well, there's a lot of dormant buds in the branches and in the trunk. And as long as the tree is not topped or severely pruned, those buds will stay dormant. Because trees have what we call apical dominance. That means the top of the tree controls the growth of the whole tree. Some trees have very strong apical dominance, some species. Other species, it's not so strong, and their pattern of growth reflects that. So when you cut off the top of a tree, how does it respond? Let's look at our next picture, number 6, and it'll show you. And you've seen it, obviously. If you can't drive, you really can't drive around Southern California without seeing headed trees that were topped. And so here you see the cuts have been made, at the very ends of the branches. This is severe pruning. And then what happens is you get the proliferation of shoots at the pruning wound, like that. Now these new shoots tend to grow rapidly and tall. And of course, if you look over here, they've made a large cut, and then you're going to break growth all over the place. And that's not a good, that's not good for the tree. It's a poor growth response. It disrupts the natural form of the tree, and it opens up the tree to decay because you've made large wounds. So after someone's done this to a tree, you've got to come back and try and do what we call crown restoration, which is to fix the tree. Now, these cartoons show it okay, but let's take a look at number 7, which shows it even clearer. This is a jacaranda tree, and this is a large cut. That's good, maybe a 3 to 4 inch cut. And now, two things to see. First off is the proliferation of shoots. These shoots took off and grew pretty fast. Within 6 months, you see all these shoots coming up. Come back in a year and a half, and these new shoots will be 2 or 3 inches in diameter. And the bark on them is smooth. The bark here is rough. This is old mature bark. This is young bark. And the problem with this growth response is it disrupts the natural form. Plus, these branches are poorly attached to this trunk or other branch. And now let's talk about why that is. When a tree is young and you've got a trunk, and here's the trunk, it's like this, and you've got a branch. And typically in the spring on most trees, the trunk will grow a little bit, and then in the summer, the branch grows a little bit. And that happens year after year. The trunk grows, the branch grows, the trunk grows, the branch grows. You come back after maybe 5, 10 years, or whatever time period you want to pick, and you've got a big trunk and a nice branch. That branch goes to the middle of the tree. It is secure. It's not likely to fall off or rip or fall off the tree. When you whack a tree and you've got a big cut and you get all those shoots coming up, and you come back a year later and maybe 100 shoots come up on a large cut, a 6, 8, 10 inch cut, and you come back in a year or two, and there's 4, 5, or 6 that survived, and all the others died off. And they've all grown very fast. And they'll grow as much as 20 feet before they branch. But they're only attached to the very edge of the trunk or the scaffold that was pruned. So that new growth comes up like this, but it's only attached right here. It doesn't go to the middle of the trunk. It's just on the edge. That branch can then rip and fall off the tree quite easily, and it happens all the time. It's not just maybe it'll happen. I can guarantee it's going to happen at some point later on in that tree. So after you severely prune a tree, after you top a tree, it really stresses the heck out of the tree. I mean, we talked about the guidelines, what you should do to prune to enhance the natural form, limit how much greenwood you take out to 25%, don't wound the trunk, don't make pruning wounds over 2 inches. And we'll talk about some other, the art of pruning in a moment, but how do you pick what branches to prune? But when you don't follow those guidelines, what happens? You make large cuts in the tree. You get new branches proliferate. Those are weakly attached. You have a large pruning wound, which is now open to decay. You're going to get this kind of stuff growing off the side of your tree because you opened up the trunk to decay. Never let anyone climb your tree with spikes and poke the trunk full of holes. I can't think of anything that would possibly be worse than poking the trunk full of holes. I mean, a tree that is so badly cared for, you know, a few years later, when I show up to give someone an opinion of what I think they should do with their tree, I often have to tell them, you should cut that tree down. It's got too many problems. So we looked at that proliferation of shoots. The other thing that can happen, you know, when you severely prune a tree and you defoliate it, you cut off all the branches and you take off all the leaves, is now the tree is in shock and doesn't have any food. It's not making any food. It has no leaves. So its first response is to grow as many new leaves as it can, as fast as it can. And you often get growth right on the trunk of the tree, leaves right on the, growing right off the trunk of the tree, little small branches covered with leaves. That's called epicormic growth. When you have foliage growing right off the trunk, that is a sign of stress in the tree. If the tree had any other problem, if it had root rot, if it had some other problem with the tree, some kind of disease or insect problem, when you severely prune trees, that problem is going to get much worse. And I have seen trees die within a few months of severe pruning. Those trees had armillaria root rot, which is the oak root rot fungus, armillaria mellea, quite common throughout Southern California. I saw some on Friday on a cherry tree out in Laverne. It's all over the San Gabriel Valley. I see it all over the West LA area, so it's really everywhere. You can find it really in anyone's garden, almost. And so if you've got a tree that has a little bit of that on it, and maybe the tree's doing okay and you severely prune it, bang, the tree can die on you. So there was this particular instance, it was a blue gum eucalyptus with a big 4-foot trunk, which is really inappropriate for most residential uses in the first place. And it was severely pruned. It broke a whole bunch of new growth and then died. That severe pruning was just too much for that tree given its poor root health. So you can exasperate problems you already have. Now let's look at our next picture and we'll talk about narrow crotches. This is number 8, and bring that up full screen. Narrow crotches are structural faults in trees. Some trees tend to make them. This couldn't be a more narrow crotch. You can see, you know, and so this is very poorly attached to the trunk. This has a nice angle of attachment. This goes to the middle of the tree. This probably grew in response to severe pruning at some previous time in the history of the tree. But jacarandas are known for growing what we call water sprouts or and developing narrow crotches. So let's just talk about, we'll talk about that last, actually. Let's move on to our next picture and talk again about heading and what we call drop crotch pruning. Now, sometimes you just have to cut the top of a tree out. It might have died. Maybe in a windstorm, the top of the tree broke. And right here, it's all jagged because the wind came in and snapped this tree off. And now you want to clean this broken end or whatever valid reason you have for making such a large cut is you want to prune to a side branch that's 1/3 the size of the trunk. So if the trunk were, let's just say, 3 feet, which would be a very big trunk, you'd cut back to a side branch that's 1 foot. And, you know, make it a little easier. If it's a 12-inch cut, then you'd 1/3 of that is 4 inches. And it's a guideline, you know. You want to cut back to a side branch, and this will minimize the growth response. Because when you have this pruning wound right here, you're going to get a lot of new shoots coming up. So to minimize that growth response, you prune back to a side branch. You don't want to make your cut out here. This whole section then will just die and be really prone to decay. You want to make it here, and hopefully it will callus over and seal. So now you don't want to let a large scaffold or a trunk rip the bark. So you make your first cut here. You make a second cut here. And when this comes off, it won't rip down here. And then you make a final cut like that. maybe not that steep. So now let's talk about our next one, cutting sequence. Now that was main trunk, but if say you're cutting off a branch that's died or broken or decayed or whatever, or is blocking a sign or whatever the problem is, you don't want to just start cutting it here, because then it will hinge, it'll start to fall, and this part here will stay attached, and it will rip as it goes. This will all go with it, and you'll have a big wound here. So you want to make very sure that that doesn't happen. So you make your first cut here, you make a second cut here. As you're cutting, this is going to start to go, but this is cut, so it'll just fall off. Then you'll end up with a piece about this big left over. Well, actually, it's not going to be there. It's going to be right here. This may be kind of jagged like that. Then you're going to come in and make your third cut right here, just outside the branch collar. That way, you'll prevent this branch from hinging and tearing the bark down the trunk. If it's a smaller branch, you can just use a lopper and cut it right on the branch. But you know, say this is a 4-inch branch, you're very likely to have this hinge and rip the trunk. And rips never, ever heal properly. A ripped bark is one of the worst injuries you can cause on a tree. Now let's take a look at my horror photo display of severe pruning. Let's bring up 11 and show you what was once a Magnolia grandiflora. Now it's still a Magnolia grandiflora, but it's a butchered southern magnolia. And there's no reason for this. Now this is 99% of the foliage is gone. There are large wounds everywhere. Everywhere. This is going to be a disaster. Now the growth response is going to all be at the tips. So it's going to do exactly what those cartoons said. You're just going to get all this new growth at the tips. You might end up with growth all along the trunk, too, because this tree is going to be in severe stress because of such a severe pruning. This is not a deciduous tree. So let's take a look at our next one, 12. This is, again, a Magnolia grandiflora that's been severely pruned for no reason at all. Topped, all the foliage taken off. This. If you want to do this, make your cut down here, right at the soil line, and plant a new tree. This is, our next one is the umbrella tree. And you can see the size of the pruning. Maybe they're in the process of cutting this whole tree down, because this makes no sense at all. Why you would cut this part of the tree off and leave this part of the tree, because now you just create an asymmetrical tree. Umbrella trees are a very tough tree, easy to grow. And then, of course, our next one, 14, is the epitome of bad pruning. They made one cut there. Maybe they brought it all down slowly, but their final cut is right in here somewhere. And the tree now is just going to grow a million shoots in a million directions. And this is a Chinese elm. Chinese elms will tolerate severe pruning. That doesn't mean it's good for them. Number 15, this is an olive tree that's been severely pruned. They've removed 90% of the foliage. If you do this in the spring, especially the late spring, when the summer comes, the sun is going to come down and hit these branches and burn the bark on the tops of the branches. All along here, you'll get burned bark. Wherever it's exposed, you're going to burn the bark in the summer months. That'll be a permanent injury when it burns. It's going to be open to decay. So you do not want to expose the trunk or the branches to full sun during the summer months. That's really detrimental to the health of trees. So let's take a look at our next one. These are coral trees, again, severely pruned. Now, coral trees tend to develop narrow crotches and very large scaffolds. This one is actually double trunked, but you can see, all these very narrow crotches. So coral trees have a tendency to drop once they get a big trunk, a big scaffold or a big, divided trunk. They tend to rip and fall off. So people do this thinking that they're going to prevent that. And in fact, they've just badly, badly injured the tree. Let's take a look at our next one. And this tree was severely pruned and then never grew back. So this is an example of a tree that was severely pruned. all these major scaffolds were cut off. I don't know if they knew that the tree would, you know, die soon after. If you do this to pines, pines are in general very intolerant of severe pruning. And a lot of other trees are also intolerant, especially oaks. Now there's another thing that people do often, and it's shown in our next picture, number 18, and that is lion tailing. And lion tailing is when you strip all the foliage off the off of a trunk and you leave a little clump at the end. So here you go, it's all cut off and then there's a little clump of foliage at the end. This will encourage what we call water sprouts. Water sprouts are shoots that grow straight off of branches like this. They do this. This will encourage, because when the sun comes down and hits this, the tree is going to respond by growing new foliage. These act like separate little individual trees. I was talking about apical dominance. The top of the tree up here somewhere is controlling the growth of the whole tree. Well, water sprouts don't respond to apical dominance. Each one of these new shoots, if you come back in 6 months or a year, you'll have shoots coming up off all these branches growing straight up. Each one is going to act like a separate individual tree and try and outcompete the others to get to the sunlight. And it's going to disrupt the natural form of the tree completely. When you lion tail, you encourage this. Plus, if this grows quite a bit, and it probably will, this is going to get heavy and it's going to pull the branch down and you're going to get bow branching. So the two things that are really bad about lion tailing is encouraging water sprouts and causing bow branching. So very poor technique. Overthinning, let's take a look at number 19, just taking out too much foliage. This is a Canary Island pine. It was pruned and there was too much taken out of it, and you can see a lot of growth all along the branches. It's responding with rapid new growth. It's not good for the tree. And now I was talking about epicormic growth. I'm going to show you my next picture is number 20. This is a eucalyptus, probably blue gum, eucalyptus globulus, but I'm not sure. And it was topped and all the branches were cut off. And you come back in 6 months and it's just solid growth. This one as well, this one as well. And so this is indicating the tree is in severe stress because of all that epicormic growth. I can show you a million of these pictures, but I'll just show you a few. Number 21, this is Pinus canariensis, the Canary Island pine. And you can see all the growth, all this foliage is growing right on the trunk, indicating the tree is in severe stress. I don't recall what the top looked like when I took this picture out in the valley. And let's continue with some more severe pruning. And number 22, this tree has, of course, been topped, and every year they come back and just cut off the ends of the branches, like that. So during the winter, this is a liquid amber, the American sweet gum. It's not a gum like a eucalyptus, but it's called American sweet gum, native to the New England area, northeast of North America. And so, you know, you're going to get decay up here. You're going to get a lot of new shoots growing up here, and then you'll have decay too, and so they'll want to fall off the tree in a little windstorm. So this is really bad. Now let's take a look at our next one, 23. And this is also a liquid amber that has not been topped. And so it's got all its branches. And so you can prune this tree to enhance its natural form. Now there is a problem with this tree is it comes up and it turns into two trunks. This is the main trunk, but this one comes up pretty high. So if you want to trim this tree, you do need to shorten this one and discourage its growth and encourage a central leader. And we'll talk about why that's so important in a minute. Because we want central leaders on our trees. We want one central leader. We don't want two or three. So if I were trimming this, I might prune it back to here, or I might even prune it back to here. That's drop crotch pruning or heading back. I might come in and head this back a little bit, but you know, right in here. But you know, you want to limit it to 25% of the canopy. You want to enhance its natural form. I'm not going to come in here and head back the central leader because I want that central leader there. It controls the growth of the whole tree. And let's take a look at number 24. Again, good-looking trees that have not been topped. You see? Now, here's the central leader. Well, let me see if I can follow that up. Here's the central leader here, it comes up, and then it breaks into a bunch of nice, you know, it looks like a tree. This one comes up now right here, it divides. And that's a structural fault, so you want to deal with that. You don't want, you see, this is a very narrow crotch right there. That's a structural fault. These branches are nice. They're distributed radially and vertically along the trunk. And we'll talk about that when talking about pruning young trees. Our next picture is a Chinese elm that's been turned into a ball. I guess if that's what you want to do with your tree, it's your tree. You can do whatever you want, but it sure isn't a tree anymore. And then this next picture is just a really hilarious picture that I took after a friend of mine told me about this. And I don't understand why they pruned it like this in the first place, but they left this little ring of leaves at the bottom and a little puff at the top. This is a Mexican fan palm, which is Washingtonia robusta. And they grow fast. They grow, you know, a foot a year or more. And they get to 75 to 100 feet. Maybe not a full 100 feet, but this is just going to shoot up. But when it does grow, because they took off all the leaves right here, when you come back later, it's going to come up like this, then it's going to get real narrow, and then it's going to get bigger again. When you take off all the fronds on a palm tree, you get a pencil, what we call a pencil trunk, where it gets narrower and then bigger. Now let's talk about pruning young trees. Because there's a lot of issues about when to prune trees. And I alluded earlier that it's usually best to prune trees when they're dormant. And that's true. But there's another time to prune trees, and that's when you plant them. When you plant a young tree in a 5-gallon pot or a 15-gallon pot or maybe even a 1-gallon pot, because you will get your best trees from the smallest trees, you need to train them the first few years to avoid structural faults. And we talked about narrow crotches. The other problem, I want to remind our viewers that we're live and on the air, and you can give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 and ask me about your trees. And we'll talk about, you've got a problem tree, or you want to know how to prune a tree, or what trees to select for Southern California, give me a call. So, young trees. You put in a new tree, and often in nursery production, they've been headed back to make them thicker and bushier, because that will happen. They look better in the nursery. It's not how you want to grow it in the landscape. So say you got three shoots coming off of a trunk. When you plant that tree, you only want one central leader. This is for shade trees, not so much for fruit trees. We'll talk about fruit trees in a minute. So you got one central leader, and the other ones you want to get rid of. Now, you pick one of those shoots, one of those central leaders. The tallest one, the straightest one, is usually the one you want to keep. The others, you want to get rid of them, but you don't want to get rid of them immediately. What you do is you head them back a few inches, and that will dwarf them. They'll grow a little slower, and you'll come back in a year and take them off entirely. But you're going to dwarf those other leaders and pick one. Now, that one's going to shoot much faster than the others because you cut off the others. And the same is true for side branches. You do not want to cut off your side branches when you plant the tree. Now you want your first scaffolds to be at about 10 to 12 feet so you can walk under your tree. That's generally true. For street trees, you might want your first scaffolds at 14 feet to allow for traffic on the street. But for a tree in your backyard or your front yard that's, you know, not close to vehicular traffic, then you can plan your first scaffolds for about 10 feet off the ground to 12 feet off the ground. So, but when you plant your tree, you're going to have some shoots growing off the trunk. You want to leave those shoots on there, but you are going to cut them off in about a year. What you do is you nip about 2 to 3 inches off the ends of those side branches to dwarf them. So when you take them off in a year or so, you have a smaller wound. What do those side branches do for your tree? What do? They feed the trunk. You get faster caliper expansion or trunk, you know, the trunk gets thicker faster if you leave the side branches on. They shade the trunk from full sun. It's very important that you shade the trunk from the full sun the first few years of its growth until it can grow a canopy and shade its own trunk. If you've ever driven up in the Central Valley, up in, you know, through Fresno and up either 5 or 99, and you'll see a lot of new plantings of fruit trees, maybe almonds or something like that. And you'll see these white plastic sleeves on the trunk of the tree. That is to protect the trunk from the full sun, also to protect it from rodents that can chew on the trunk, but primarily to protect the trunk from full sun, especially on the west and south side of a tree. I have seen sunburn on trees many, many, many times because people prune up the branches too low when the tree is young. And in the afternoon, in August and September, when it's hot, the sun starts falling or setting on the western, in the west, or on the south, and that sun comes in and it's 100 degrees out or 110 degrees out, and it just fries the bark. So protect your trunk from full sun. Do not remove the side branches until the tree is a year or two old and it's starting to shade itself. Now let's take a look at some more, we'll talk about this. Let's take a look at 27 about training young trees and bring this up full screen. Now this is a street tree planted in South Pasadena, and here are these side branches. These are way too low, especially for a street tree, and they were allowed to grow along. You know, these are long now. When this was planted, these should have been nipped off right about here, and right about here, and right about here. Then you're going to come back after about a year, year and a half or so, and cut them off like this, so that you, and then, you know, your first scaffolds aren't even present on the tree until it gets, you know, about 15 feet tall, because that's when you're going to start developing those large scaffolds. Staking trees. Let's take a look at number 28. And this tree is staked. When you buy a tree, it will come with a nursery stake tied right up against the trunk like this. Okay? You want to get rid of that immediately. That's not good for the tree. It will injure the trunk of the tree if you leave it on there. Now, this part up here is not necessary. But you want to take two stakes on either side of the tree, with the tree in the middle. And then you want to reach up to about chest height. This is a little low, actually. And so you usually want that right around here. And then you want to use a flexible material. You don't want to tie up the tree tight. The tree should be able to move in the wind a little bit. And so you can use a old hose, wrap it in a figure eight like that around there. But it's going to prevent the tree from flopping over. But it's going to hold the tree up, and that movement in the wind back and forth actually causes the trunk to strengthen and get stronger. So now this is a little low. You should probably head this back to about here or here, and then this is too low. This one needs to be headed back to about here, and this one needs to be headed back, because when you come back in a year or two, you're going to remove these entirely, because your first scaffold, this may be your first scaffold here, actually. So this is how you stake a tree, but this is a little more than is necessary. And now let's talk again about V-shaped and U-shaped crotches, or narrow crotches. Let's look at number 29. This is a U-shaped crotch. This is a V-shaped or narrow crotch. This is okay. These are attached pretty well to the trunk. This is not okay. This is included bark right down here, and one of these can rip and fall off quite easily. That is why when you train a young tree, you don't want either of these conditions, actually. You want one that goes up like this with branches coming off like this. Some trees don't grow that way, but you can try and force them. If you allow, if you've got a young tree that has, you know, two leaders, or maybe three, it'll take off and these will get bigger and bigger and bigger, and you're going to come back in years, and now you're going to have multiple branch attachment at the same point, and it's not going to be good. You're going to have what we call bowl branching, and that's what we can see in this next picture on number 30. This is called bowl branching, where all these shoots were allowed to develop, and now this tree is quite old. This is a silver maple, and this reinforces what I said earlier, that silver maples are prone to decay. That's a decay pocket right there. Here's a decay pocket, there's a decay pocket. This branch was cut off at some point, big wound. It's callus. This is callus right in here. All this is right here is callus. But you probably have a hollow trunk. But look at this. All this, this is bowl branching. You can't fix this now. There's nothing you can do about it. It should have been done when it was a little tiny tree and had all these multiple leaders. You're going to cut off these and pick one to become a central leader. Let's look at another example, bowl branching, number 31. And you can see here, now this looks like, I don't recognize the species right off the bat. But you've got one, two, and I think a third one back in the back. But at least you have codominant leaders. You don't want codominant leaders, you want one central leader. Now, there's another rule of thumb, is that you want your scaffolds to be one-third the size of the trunk. So if you have a 3-foot trunk, which is a big, big trunk, you would want your scaffolds to be about 1 foot. If you have a 24-inch trunk, a third of that would be 8 inches. So your scaffolds are about this big. If your trunk is about this big, then your scaffolds. If the scaffold branches, the large main branches of your tree, are the same size as the trunk, they're much more prone to rip and fall off the tree. So if we look at our next picture, which is Ficus microcarpa, and bring that up full screen, what you'll see is some very large scaffold branches that are just too big. So here is your trunk, and here is your scaffold, your first scaffold. It's too low. It's coming about, maybe 3 or 4 feet off the ground. And this is a big parkway. This is in Alhambra. And then you got this bowl branching up here, too. And this species, Ficus microcarpa, is prone to this. But this picture is to show you this is really too large for this size trunk. This should have been removed when it was planted, and it was a little tiny side branch. You nip it, dwarf it for a year, year and a half, and then come back and cut it off the trunk entirely. So you end up with one trunk coming up and then developing your major scaffolds up here. Now what you want is your scaffolds to be distributed radially around the trunk and vertically around the trunk evenly. You don't want branches overlapping them, other branches below. So if you're coming up, you have a branch. Come up, you've got a branch. Come up, you've got a branch. So they're distributed radially around the tree and vertically on the tree. You don't want overlapping branches where they're hanging right on top of each other. You don't want crossing branches. And that goes to my next point about pruning trees. How do you prune the tree, actually prune the tree? When a professional tree pruner prunes a tree, usually the first thing he does is climbs to the top of the tree. He puts his rope, his climbing rope, into the tree and then starts working down the tree. As he's working down the tree, what's he going to remove? Number one, deadwood. Dead branches can be removed at any time. Next are what we call crossing branches, branches that cross each other. They start on one side and they turn and they come out the other side of the tree. That's not how you want to prune. That disrupts its form. So you can remove deadwood, crossing branches, and then you remove overlapping branches. And that's where the art comes in. If you've got two branches that are right on top of each other, like this, which one are you going to remove, the top one or the bottom one? That's a judgment call. When I used to trim trees, and I guess I'm still trimming trees, is I will move a branch, and I try and visualize the branch gone. And I think, okay, is that going to punch a hole in the canopy? Am I going to end up with an asymmetrical tree? And then I move the other branch. Is that going to, if I remove that, what's it going to look like? So that's the key, is visualizing the loss of that branch. You know one of them has to go because they're right on top of each other and you don't want overlapping branches. So you got to figure out which one. Typically, for whatever reason, I tend to remove the lower branch. But it really depends on where other branches are in the canopy and how big a hole I'm going to leave. But I will end up taking one of them off. Let's take a look at another picture. Oh, I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller. Terry, calling from Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yes, I have a question about my fruit. I want to grow fruit trees.
Okay.
And I wanted to know what kind of apple or peach or nectarine tree that would be really good for the San Gabriel Valley.
Well, that's a good question. It's very important that you select varieties that are appropriate for where where you live. One of the key things about both those groups, apples and pears or stone fruits, the peaches, nectarines, apricots, plums, is what we call vernalization, which is a cold chill requirement for the winter months. When you take a look at a particular type of peach, It will give you, if you get the information on that variety, it'll tell you how many hours of chill it requires in the winter in order to bloom well in the spring and set a lot of fruit. There are three low chill variety apples that do quite well in Southern California. There's Beverly Hills, Anna, and Gordon. All of those require less than 500 hours of chill. And that's kind of the cutoff. 500 hours is pretty much a good cutoff, especially for the inland areas, the San Fernando Valley, the San Gabriel Valley. You know, if you're up in Altadena, you might be able to grow something that requires 600 or even 700 hours. If you're up in Big Bear, you could grow something that requires 900 hours. But if you grow stuff that requires 500 hours or more, and you're down in the lower in the valley, you may get very poor flowering, because if your tree doesn't go dormant in the winter, it does not flower well in the spring. So the Gordon, the Anna, and the Beverly Hills, three very good apple varieties for Southern California. When it comes to peaches and the nectarines, there are so many varieties out there. The key, though, is picking varieties that require 500 hours or less. Now, you don't have to go much below 500 hours. If you're down at the beach, where they get even less chill, you're going to need something that needs 300 or 200 hours of chill. Now, I have with me, as a matter of fact, because I brought it in, the guide from Ellie Cook. Let's go to the overhead real quick, because this is a very good question.
Okay.
And Ellie Cook is one of the biggest growers of fruit trees in the western United States, and they're up in the valley. And they've got an edible fruit guide. If we could go to the overhead camera, I want to show you this fruit guide. Here it is.
Okay.
And let's just leaf through it real quick and get, they talk about a lot of things. It's a really nice, so here we go, apples. And it says right here, now you probably can't read it, it's too small. Anna, large, light greenish yellow skin with slight red blush, sweet, slightly tart, crisp, creamy white flesh, good choice for salads, pies, applesauce, eating fresh from the tree. It's a wonderful apple, by the way, because my father grows it. Stores well. A remarkable low chilling selection from Israel, especially suited for Southern California. 200 to 300 hours. You could actually grow Anna right at the beach. It requires so few apples. That's Anna. Beverly Hills is 300 hours. And let's see if the Gordon is here. Gordon, 300 to 500 hours. So you see Gordon would do quite well even, you know, does very well in the San Gabriel Valley. If we go on to the peach section, that's just apples, because these guys, you know, Ellie Cook grows everything. Babcock is a good peach for the San Gabriel Valley, 350 to 400 hours. But if you look at some, Bonita is 250. Here, Bella of Georgia, 800 hours. You should not try and grow that in the San Gabriel Valley. You would have to grow that maybe in Oregon or Washington, where they get, you know, snow, or maybe up at Big Bear. Southern Rose, these are patio peaches, 250. So there's quite a few peaches that have low chill requirements. Desert Gold does well, 300 to 400 hours. Some of them will be early season, some will be mid-season, some will be late season. So that's the kind of thing that you have to decide on your own. But this is the Ellie Cook Edible Fruit Descriptive Guide. You can get it off their website. Just do Ellie Cook on Google.
Uh-huh.
And you can find their website and look at, you know, they've got these point of sale brochures for each of their varieties they grow, and take a look at that. It'll tell you whether it's a freestone or a cling. It'll tell you when it ripens in the season, whether it's early, mid-season, or late.
Okay.
And then you can.
Well, that sounds really good. I'll have to look at that website. That's for sure.
Pick the one that does best for you. You know, you may. You know, generally, if you've got the space and can grow more than one peach, you can grow one for the early season, one mid-season, one late season.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't want them all ripening at the same time. You may also want to pick a semi-dwarf or dwarf if you have a space restriction. Generally, they need to be planted about 10 to 12 feet apart, unless you're growing dwarfs. And then you can crowd them and you can have more varieties.
Okay. Well, gosh, that's a lot of information. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you for the call, and it was a timely question. And thank you for watching the show. So, yeah, that's really important when you're selecting fruit trees, is you select varieties that will do well in where you live. And there are a lot of low-chill varieties now of apples and pears. You can grow pears in Southern California. Just a moment. I'm a little parched. But let's, what did I do with my glasses? So, before we go on anymore in the lecture, I'd like to talk about, we talked about how you prune a tree in terms of selecting where the cuts are going to be made and how you're going to prune it. But how do you get up into a big tree and prune it? And how do you select someone to prune your tree to make sure that you're hiring someone who would top your tree, who would just go up with a chainsaw and cut all the branches off and say, ah, I'm done. So let's take a look at this first video I want to show you, which is Jack Richardson, tree climber. He's going to show you how he climbs trees. This is important because a professional tree trimmer should be using this type of equipment. Let's look at Jack.
Hi, I'm Jack Richardson, owner of Guardian Tree Experts. We're a tree care company here in Ann Arbor. And this is my colleague, Chris Adler.
Hi.
So we're going to take a look at climbing a tree today. As arborists, we're forced to do this quite often. And so we're going to go through the process of how we get into a tree safely, move around in a tree, simulate working conditions, and then how we come down.
Yeah, maybe we'll just try this one.
Yeah, why don't
I'm happy to do that.
When removing trees, you know, people have seen the spikes on the feet, you know, that loggers wear. And when we take trees down, we wear spikes because it is easier to move around. When pruning trees that are going to stay in the landscape, spikes hurt the tree, so we can't climb with them. So we have to find another way to get into the tree. And that's what this is, this throw line. And I'm going to open this up here, take a look. But inside this cube is a weighted pouch that's about 12 ounces, and it's on a string. And we can throw this up to about 90 feet in the air. And basically we try to get it over a limb that's strong enough, drop it down to the ground, and then we can tie our climbing line on and pull that up, and that's what we'll ascend on, is our climbing line. It can be really frustrating. Some days you're on, other days it's getting hung up everywhere, so it's kind of a daily challenge, but we'll go ahead and try to set something up in this walnut here. You want to edit that one out. Heads up.
We have to look for hazards in the tree. Widowmakers, sometimes it'll be large limbs that are stuck up there. We don't want to climb up and get hit by something like that. Bees are another big issue. Raccoons and squirrels.
So what we're going to be climbing here is a walnut, a black walnut, and some of the things we need to look for before we actually climb a tree is it safe to climb? Are there any defects, splits, or decay? We want to make sure we're not tied into any of those places. Isolated over a limb. We can clip our climbing line into it. This is, what is this?
It's lava.
Anyways, 24-strand Kern mantle rope. So everything that we climb with in our system has to be rated over 5,000 pounds. And again, you know, I'm 185, so I'm never going to really generate that much force. But so this line's rated about 5,400 pounds. All right. So we've installed our line, and it's away from the trunk, which means we can't use our bodies at all to get up, walking up the trunk or anything like that. So in this particular situation, we're going to have to footlock, and we'll go ahead and show you how that works.
This can sometimes be the most difficult part of the day, is putting the saddle on without falling over. It's a very therapeutic thing to do, especially for me. When life gets kind of hectic and crazy, it's really nice to just disappear into a tree for a little while, climb around there. You're so focused on what you're doing, before you know it, you know, your day is over.
So getting that line up in the tree can be the biggest challenge, you know, to start climbing the tree. One thing he didn't show you was the knot that is used for ascending and descending the tree. And it's called a tautline hitch. It's a friction knot. When you hang on it and put friction on it, it cinches. When you pull on the knot itself, it slides, it slips. Sometimes referred to as a slip knot. But it's sometimes also referred to as a monkey hitch. And I'll show you how to tie that knot in a minute. But I want to go back and show you a few more things about trees themselves. Let's take a look at number 33. I want to show you another narrow crotch. Bring that up full screen. And you can see this narrow crotch right here. We've switched to red on our screen here. It shows up better. Here's a very large scaffold. Actually, this trunk comes up and then divides into two trunks. And so they're huge. And this is a narrow crotch. And this is, you know, this comes all the way down here. This could easily rip and fall off. So you avoid this when the tree is little and it's tiny and it's got the two shoots. You cut one off and you pick one to become the central leader. Now, if you don't, let's take a look at number 34. This is what can happen, is this can rip. And this wound will never, ever heal. This is a permanent wound in the tree. Number 35 shows a similar problem. This is in Eaton Canyon. This is a California coastline oak. Now here, it's, you can see it's all hollow. It's been decayed out. But this tree came up like this and then had this leader, and then it had another one here, wherever it was growing. This, and they're not attached to each other, and so this one fell off. Now, the decay here played a role in that as well. But let's take a look at number 36. We talked about ripping, and that's what happens when you have these large scaffolds that break off a tree, is they tear, as they fall off the tree, they tear the bark. This is flush cutting, where you've cut it, you know, right along the edge of the trunk, and you leave a very large wound instead of leaving a little wound. Of course, here they just started cutting, and when they got to this point, this fell and ripped the bark. So that's very important. There's a couple other ways to damage trees. Let's take a look at number 37. This is an old stake and tie that was left on the tree, and now here's the stake, here's the trunk. Who's holding up who? The tree is really holding up the stake at this point. This stake should only be on the tree for about 1 year. But these ties are going to constrict the growth of the trunk right here, and you will have a permanent weakness right here. And I've seen these break off right along here because of this exact type of staking injury. Let's take a look at number 38. And you can see that this has been left here, and here are these ties, and this is, makes a permanent weakness in the trunk right there, and this can break and fall off. So you only stake a tree for 1 year, maybe a year and a half. Now let's take a look at some massive tree failures. Number 39, this is a eucalyptus tree failure in a park in Los Angeles. This whole thing, here's the root system right here. Here's this trunk, which is probably about a 3 to 4 foot trunk. This came down, they've cleaned up part of it. It's probably a 75-foot blue gum eucalyptus. How big is that that stump, you think? We'll take a look at number 40, and you'll see how big that is. Here's an individual standing, and here's the stump that came over. It's big. Now, so, you know, tree care is critical on large trees. How you take care of them is so important. If a large tree like this falls over next to your home, it's just going to crush it. If it lands on somebody, it will probably kill them. And that has happened. It happens, unfortunately, every year. You see it in the paper. Somebody is killed by a falling tree, or the other thing is often a tree worker is killed. Let's take a look at 41, because a friend of mine who runs a nursery up in Altadena, which is Nuzio's nursery, and here's Tom Nuzio right here, and this eucalyptus fell in his nursery, and it landed on this tree, right, this car. Luckily, it didn't hit anybody, but it's got a lot of decay down here. And let's take a look at the base of the tree as our next picture, 42. And you can see this decay right in here. Now, this was a triple-trunked eucalyptus. You had a lot of decay in the base of the old tree. That's not unusual, and it's hollow down in here, and this comes crashing down. Luckily, it didn't hit anybody. Now, this is one of the oddest things that someone sent me. And let's take a look at our next picture, 43. This is a split on a pine, and this just split one day. Unfortunately, that pretty much means this tree has to be removed. This is now just too dangerous to allow. It's going to decay. Maybe it's not going to fall over next week or in 6 months or even a year, but in a relatively short time frame compared to the life of a tree, in maybe 5 years or so, this is going to be all decayed in here. And then this base is just going to be weak and it can come toppling down. So you got to be really careful if you see this. I've never seen this ever happen to a tree before. Maybe it's starting to fall down already, but it would really indicate to me that that tree has to be cut down immediately or as soon as possible. Now I have another video clip that I want to show you. This is from the European Tree Climbing Championship. Some of you may not be aware that there are competitions for tree climbing, but let's take a look at this next clip. It's the Still, S-T-I-H-L, Still makes chainsaws, sponsorship, European Tree Climbing Championship from 2011. Let's take a look at this because it'll show you some of their tree climbing skills and who you want in your tree to trim your tree.
Vienna. According to the Mercer study, the city with the world's highest standard of living. The cityscape is filled with historical buildings, along with the Wiener Prater, the place host to the 15th European Tree Climbing Championships.
So we are here now in Prater Park in Vienna. We selected this park, but we cannot just go into these trees just like this. We have to prepare these trees, and that's what we are doing now.
A total of 8 trees in the park have to be prepared for the contest, a very important task that isn't taken lightly. For a professional contest, we need some professional preparation. This means that the ground around the trees first has to be cleared of grass and weeds so that the athletes have a good stand. Then the trees have to be cleared of rotten or overhanging branches out of safety reasons. So the final preparations on the 4 linden, 2 oak and 2 black poplar trees are carefully carried out. Then the Prater Amusement Park is ready for the start of the European Championships that take place in Austria for the first time in the history of the contest. 53 tree climbers from 17 nations will start the first day of the contest and try to qualify for the final. Both the men and women start together, although they are judged separately.
Basically, we start the competition with 5 preliminary events, and the top competitors from those 5 preliminary events will advance to what we call the Master's Challenge.
The separate disciplines are derived from the working practices of an arborist, and the first one is the throw line.
The throw line is an event where we use a small string and a weighted bag to set our lines in the tree. So there are various targets in the tree, but that's a very, very important technique to be good in tree climbing.
After the rope is securely fastened on the tree, it can be climbed, and that's the second discipline, the secured footlock. The footlock technique is how the climber ascends the 15-meter rope in the quickest possible time without any assistance from outside. The fastest competitors can do this in an unbelievable time of around 15 seconds. After reaching the crown of the tree, the real work can start. And this is our third challenge, the work climb.
Work climb is a simulated working environment where the climbers start up in the tree and move to five different workstations where they perform different tasks.
Almost all of the tasks to be carried out in the tree happen consecutively in this test of skill and strength. This makes the work climb the most complex discipline in the qualifications. But the crowning discipline is known as the aerial rescue.
The aerial rescue, again, simulates a scenario where a worker is injured aloft and you have to come into to that area and safely get up into the tree, assess their injuries or whatever the situation is, and then try to safely bring them down to the ground so that they could be given some additional treatment by EMTs.
Whereas the aerial rescue is a great opportunity to practice for real-life situations, the last event is far away from the everyday work scenario, the belayed speed climb. Of all of the disciplines in the preliminaries, the belayed speed climb is the most unusual in respect to the normal work. They are secured by someone else and it's all about speed. This is different to a normal day's work where they have to secure themselves. The belayed speed climb is maybe unusual for the professionals, but this is maybe the best definition of tree climbing for most of us. The top five men and three women qualify for the so-called Masters Challenge, the main finals on the second day of the contest.
The Masters is only one event where we put all the skills they need for the preliminaries together, so this master event will show the European champion.
In the women's contest, Philippa Allen was providing the surprises, although she wasn't expecting it.
You know, everybody wants to win, of course, but I have to be realistic. I'm probably looking at third.
But sometimes things turn out differently than planned. Philippa Allen took the trophy, albeit with a little help from her fellow competitors, who both got disqualified and opened the way for an unexpected win for Philippa. Meanwhile, starting the men's contest, Moritz Teuerkauf sets a high standard as he found and completed all the tasks of the 25-minute Masters Challenge. So currently the German co-favourite is still on top of the judges' scorecards, and none of the other favourites can top his performance. But the last contestant to go isn't perturbed by the fact that he's not one of the favourites.
I'm happy to be into the Master. I try to win, yes. I don't know if I am the favourite.
Favourite or not, Ugo climbs through the tree with just as much class as Teuerkauf and conquers all of the awaiting challenges majestically. A breathtaking final develops as Giovanni Ugo reaches top form and rises up to challenge the German Teuerkauf. The tension grows as we wait for the judges' final decision. By a narrow margin, the Italian outsider defeats all of the favourites and takes a sensational victory in the Masters Challenge that earns him the title of the 2011 European Tree Climbing Champion.
So, that's always exciting to watch for me. I climbed trees for a lot of years. I ran a tree service for quite a few years. And I was never that good, I gotta tell you. I was never on that level. In fact, I wasn't very good at throwing we used to call it an avocado, but it's a weighted bag with a string, and you'd try and throw it up in the tree, and I'd hang it up. So I started using a lot of ladders. Lean a ladder into the tree, climb up into the tree, set my rope, and the crew would take the ladder away, and then I would work the tree with my rope and saddle. Now, I'm going to go ahead and move these plants out of the way because I want to show you my saddle. Saddles have changed over the years. The original saddle I had quite a long time ago is considered inadequate now and more difficult to use. So let's take a look at it. This is a saddle right here. Now this is a scabbard with a handsaw. This is a professional level type of a handsaw. Very sharp, cuts branches really nicely. If you're going to do pruning in your garden, you're going to want a quality saw. I suggest you go ahead and spend the money to get a professional level saw. And when I pruned, I used to do a lot of pruning just with my handsaw, not a lot of chainsaw work. So here's the saddle. It has this strap goes under your leg, and this one goes under your leg. And this is the D-ring that comes out in the middle. This is your safety lanyard. This goes around another branch. When you're working, you swing this around a branch, so you're tied off in two spots in the tree. And you can adjust the length of this by pulling on this knot. And if you pull on it, it slides. You see that? This is called a tautline hitch. And when you pull on it like this, it doesn't slide. But if you pull on the knot, it slides. So you can adjust, adjust that. So now these clips are actually old-fashioned clips that are not allowed anymore, although it's not that critical for your safety lanyard. But now how do you actually tie into the tree and make that tautline hitch? It's also called a monkey fist. Now what I have here is a rope bag. And your climbing rope is in this bag. Now in the old days you didn't use a rope bag. Here's one of the new clips. And the new clips won't open. They can't accidentally open. You've got to push on the back of it to get it to open. So if you just push on here, it won't open. But if you push on the back at the same time, it opens. So this is a safety clip that is much safer to use in the tree. Now you have to tie this into your rope and it clicks on. He's got this D-ring, and you see it won't go on unless I do that. Now that's on there, like that. This is on, you're wearing this. I'm not going to get up and put it on. But now you want to tie your line into here. And the way you do that, now unfortunately, oh, here it is. This is here's the clip. This is called a thimble. The line comes down through the thimble, and you put the thimble on, and then this is called a bowline. So you use a bowline to tie this, but you leave a long tail. Let me see which end is actually the tail. Here, I hope I can show you this and it's clear, because it's easier to do. So this line goes up over a branch, like my arm's a branch, and it comes back down. The tail then gets tied to here to create a loop. That loop can be adjusted. It can be, while you're climbing. So it can, and now if you're going to climb a 50-foot tree, you need a 100-foot rope, because you're going to make it go up and all the way back down. So 50-foot tree, you need a 100-foot rope. 75-foot tree, 150-foot rope. 100-foot tree, you need a 200-foot rope. These are special climbing ropes, like that earlier climber pointed out. They have to be able to bear a large load, 5,000 pounds. But they're only holding you, and most people, most climbers are probably somewhere around the 150 pounds, 175 pounds. And so you're not going to break your rope. So how do you tie that tautline hitch? Let's see if I can demonstrate it. Here's my tail that's left over when I tied in with the bowline. And I need to adjust this because this is a little screwed up now. Probably going to have to untie this at some point. What you do, and let me see if I can demonstrate it. I'm going to put this over my neck. My neck is now the branch. What you do is you wrap it twice down. That's once. That's twice. That's two wraps going down. You come back up above that and wrap twice down again. One, and one more. Now I gotta organize it and cinch it up, and there it is. So now Now, let me get this to get tight. You got to play with it a little to tighten it up. There we go. Now it's tight. Now, when I pull on this, well, let me see here. When I pull on, let me just make that a little smaller. Now, when I pull on this, well, it's a little too loose. Let me cinch it up a little better. It's got to be tight or it doesn't work. There we go. Now, when I pull on this, you see that doesn't slide. But when I pull on the knot, it slides. So let me just run that back up and make a smaller loop. There's the loop. This goes over a branch. You're hanging on to this part. And if I'm pulling on this like this, it doesn't. This knot works. See? But if I pull on it, it slides. So that's called a taut line hitch. And if we go to the overhead, I'll show you exactly what it looks like. Here it is. This is the tail. It's wrapped twice down and twice above. I'm going to go ahead and untie it. Now, another trick that you do, because you don't want that tail to slip through, and it can. Let's see here. Here's the two wraps down, and then you do two wraps above. Anyway, that's how you make a taut line hitch. And now that there are, you know, that's the simplest way to tie that knot. There's more advanced ways now. One is called a Blakely, where you actually tie two up and two down, and then bring the line back through the middle. And I'm not going to try and show you that, because I actually don't use that. Because when I learned to climb, we didn't use that. Now, and you use a bag now like this. In the old days, we also used to keep our rope differently. Now, that's an old rope. And when they get real old, they become tie-down ropes. Because you don't want to keep climbing on a rope you've climbed on for years. You want to make sure there's no nicks or cuts in your rope. You don't want to get your rope dirty. Get dirt into the rope. It wears it out. It's not good for it. So if you're going to hire a tree trimmer, they should have a saddle and a rope. They should not have spikes. Anybody who's willing to climb a tree with spikes to prune the tree doesn't know what they're doing. Bring this picture up behind me, because this is a good picture. Bring this up full screen. I just want to point out something real quick on here. And that is, you can see their climbing lines. Okay, these guys are not free climbing this tree. If they happen to, you know, slip off, they're not going to fall and kill themselves. And nothing could be worse than having somebody injured climbing a tree. And they're not wearing spikes. They're climbing the tree. They've got helmets on. They've got the proper gear. You know, people who have this type of equipment, who know what they're doing, are going to be the ones you want pruning your tree. It costs a little more. You're paying for a professional. Your trees are valuable. If you hire someone who doesn't know what they're doing, they're going to damage your tree. Now, before we move on, I want to tell you what our mystery plant is, because I often forget before the end of the show. These are aeoniums. This is the most common species, Aeonium arboreum. And this other one here is also the same species, but it's a different cultivated variety. This one's called Schwarzkopf. And let me just tell you a little bit about them from the Sunset Western Garden book about aeonium. Native to the Canary Islands, North Africa, and the Mediterranean, among the most useful succulents for decorative effects in pots or in the ground, bloom in spring and summer. Arboreum, which is this one here, and this is also arboreum, but this is called Schwarzkopf because it's really black. It's also called Atropurpureum. But it'll get to 3 feet tall. Each branch has 6 to 8 inch wide rosette of light green leaves, and that's exactly what that looks like. It's about a 6 inch rosette of light green leaves. Now this other one, this one here, is variegated. So you can get them in variegated colors. There's a real big one that probably has about a 12 inch head that's variegated with speckled with red and pink. Really, really pretty one. And I've lost the tag. I don't know which species this is, but this one here is Aeonium lindeli. And I got this at the Huntington Botanical Gardens at their annual plant sale. And this one, I don't know if it's in the book. It's not even listed in the Sunset Western Garden book, but the garden book isn't definitive for every species. But so you can, you know, say aeoniums are excellent plant materials for a dry landscape. You water them about once a month or once every 2 weeks in the summer at the most. You can leave for weeks at a time and not worry about them drying out, even in pots. So wonderful plant material for Southern California. They can freeze in extremely cold weather, so I don't think you could probably get away with them up in the mountains, like up in Big Bear. It says 15 to 17 and 20 to 24 for the zones in the Sunset Western Garden book. But that's Aeonium, and I wanted to make sure I mentioned it, what it was before the show was over. And we are coming to our last 30 minutes, and it goes quickly. Now, the other thing I wanted to talk about today was pruning fruit trees. And you prune fruit trees quite different than you prune shade trees. Shade trees, we want to diminish the response of rapid new growth. The first response to pruning is rapid new growth. We take advantage of that response in fruit trees, especially stone fruits. New growth in peaches and nectarines and plums and apricots, that new growth flowers more and produces more fruit. And we're growing fruit trees for the fruit, not necessarily as ornamentals or as shade trees, but for the fruit. So how do you prune them? Well, there's three ways to prune them. There's the open center way, and that's photograph 44. Let's take a look at that and bring that up full screen, and we'll talk about this. Now, with an open center, you cut out the central leader, and you develop three or four major scaffolds. And you do that by cutting off the tree, right like that, when it's a year old or when you plant it. And then it's going to develop these scaffolds, like four or five scaffolds. And you're going to then select usually four. And you want them distributed like this, usually a fourth like that. So that's what's called open center. That's what you use for stone fruits, particularly peaches, nectarines, and, you know, are the most common that you'd use open center. Now, the central leader is our next photograph. Let's take a look at that, number 45. Central leader is where is usually used for pears and apples. And you, you know, select a central leader, and then you're going to have a tier of branches that you develop over time. And so you can use, these are actually spacers that push the branches down. And so then the next year, it'll grow some more, and eventually you're going to end up with one, two, three tiers of branches. And you don't want these overlapping each other. But so now there's also what we call the fruit bush, and you can also have a modified central leader or open center, but this is a fruit bush. And you end up with a much lower plant, maybe only 3 to 5 feet tall, and much easier to pick your fruit. And you have, you know, more scaffolds, and you kind of cut it off right across the top, and you end up with a bushy tree. So now I've got some a video clip from the University of Massachusetts fruit advisor called Easy Fruit Easy Peach Pruning. And this is a really nice clip. I recommend it to anybody who wants to prune their stone fruits. You prune your stone fruits between December 15th and February 15th. You prune out any diseased wood, because you can have branches with cankers, either from shot hole canker, or, you know, shot hole is a fungus that causes holes in the leaves, and also peach brown rot. Both of those can get into the wood and cause these cankers. You prune out any infected wood. But really, it's about that open center and getting the most fruit you can get out of your tree. Let's take a look at this next clip, which is from the University of Massachusetts fruit advisor on easy peach pruning. can see, he took a lot of wood out of that little peach. In fact, you can take up to as much as 2/3 of the wood out of the tree, the living greenwood, when you prune a peach in the winter months. So it's really not the same at all as how we prune ornamentals. On citrus, I don't prune them that hard. I prune them more like an ornamental. I take out the dead wood, I take out some of the interior branches, and I kind of do about a 25% removal of greenwood on a citrus. Lemons are vigorous growers, and you got to keep those water sprouts. Water sprouts are the branches that grow straight up off of a side branch or a horizontal branch, and you want to stay on those quickly because lemons really produce a lot of water sprouts. So citrus aren't quite the same, but the stone fruits, you take out a lot. Now the other thing that we grow, of course, are apples and pears, very popular. Apples are probably the most popular fruit tree grown in gardens throughout the United States and throughout the world, really. So they're pruned with that central leader, and you want to select that central leader. And so I have another film clip for you from the University of Massachusetts. And I want to also mention before we go to this next clip from UMass on pruning, on apple training techniques, there are a lot of really excellent clips on YouTube on how to prune fruit trees. And you may have an older peach tree, and it's not really amenable to what we just saw. It's not a young one that you can easily train. It's got a lot of old scaffolds. And there are some good clips on pruning older peach trees, how to kind of resurrect them if they haven't been pruned. You should prune them every year. If you don't, your yield will go down dramatically. You want that new fresh growth that results from the pruning response. But let's look at this next clip, which is on pruning, or how to train apple trees, young apple trees, because you want to pick that central leader. This also applies to, actually, you should be doing the same kind of technique on new shade trees. Like I mentioned, you want a central leader. Let's take a look at this clip.
Hi, this is John Clements. Welcome to the UMass Fruit Advisor. Today is Wednesday, May 31st, on a warm, sunny day. We're out at the UMass Cold Spring Orchard in Belchertown looking at some trees that were planted last year. I have my colleague and friend, Wynn Cogill, from Rutgers Cooperative Extension with me today. Wynn is up here doing a sabbatical for the spring term with Wes Audio. And Wynn is going to talk about a couple of horticultural principles, techniques to help train these young trees that are very useful on first and second leaf trees. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Wynn, and he's going to tell you about a technique called stripping, and we'll maybe do a little pinching. The whole goal is to single out that central leader.
Thank you, John. Okay, we're going to talk today about a practice called stripping, and that is singling out the central leader so that we only have one central leader. Any young apple tree, these are two-year-old trees, get a variety of shoots, that first, second, third, fourth bud underneath the leader actually starts to grow, and we get a bush at the top. So what we're going to do is we're going to single out that leader so we have just one shoot for our central leader, and we want to get that growing up 2 to 3 feet this season. So I'm going to actually strip these younger leaders off now, side shoots rather. Now that I've got one leader left that I left, that's going to really take off. All the energy is going to go up in that shoot, and I'll get 2 to 3 feet of growth on that. I might even take a few of these younger apples off right here if I wanted to do that. We want to get that leader growing up. Okay, we're looking at another two-year-old apple tree in the orchard. We've got 3 or 4 shoots growing straight up, and we want to single this out. We call this singling the leader. I want to get it down to one leader, one shoot that'll be my leader. So I'm going to pull these shoots out, take this cluster of really dominant side shoots out, and I might even take that guy out as well. Now I've got one single shoot that's going to be my leader, and we want that to grow 2 to 3 feet. And now that there's no competition, we might take this fruit off as well. That'll grow up and make a nice leader for us this season. Okay, this is a two-year-old tree that wasn't corrected last season. So what we have now actually is a two-leader tree, and we never want that. So what we want to do is leave the most dominant shoot to be the leader. So I'm going to come in here and make a cut and take that out. And now I've got one leader that's going to take off and be a very nice central leader for me. I actually may strip that out as well so that now all my growth is here and I'm going to get a nice 2 to 3 foot leader out of this tree this year.
Okay, Wynn talked about stripping. I'm going to just briefly talk about a technique called pinching, where particularly in a vertical axis tree where we've got these short shoots coming out of the one-year growth from last year, a recommended practice is to pinch these back, take the terminal right out completely so that those will slow down and start to set up into a fruiting mode and set up fruit buds. So that's called pinching, different than stripping. And again, these are lower on the tree. They're not competing with the leader, but I do want them to be held back a little bit and not be growing up and out. This is just in the top of the tree, say about head height or above.
Okay, we've got our leader stripped out, and now we've got some competing side shoots that are growing up a little lower, but we want to save these for branches, so we want to train these. Ideally, we like to do these smaller shoots that are 6 inches or so. Here's one that's a little bit older, left from last year, and it's just a little woody, but we still have a good angle. So I've got these big blue clothespins, and we can just put it in there to get our angle right, and it rests right on the branch. And that works very well to get that little side shoot flattened out. And I'm going to do the one on the other side. And we got nice two flat shoots. We could use this blue one if we had a smaller wood one, the regular kind you use for clothes. It would work nice. So now we've got three nice shoots flattened out, and that's going to set up a couple fruit buds this summer. Slow that branch down permanently for us.
Okay, thanks, Wynn. That was great. Three techniques for training these young trees. Stripping, so we reduce the competition for the leader. A little pinching on vertical axis trees on the upper shoots to help them start to set up fruit buds. And finally, on the shoots that we want to keep for permanent branches, we want a nice flat angle on those, get them growing out. These clothespins, pinning them down with these clothespins is a great technique to use on that. So this is the time of the year to get this done, about June 1st. And again, on first and second leaf trees is the ideal time to do it. So for today, John Clements for the UMass Fruit Advisor. We'll see you next week.
So, you know, that's really important that when your trees are young is that you train them. Otherwise, if you just let them grow, they develop problems that aren't conducive for the purpose of the tree, you know, whether it's a shade tree and you let it develop codominant leaders and you end up with bull branching, or you end up with large scaffolds that are only, you know, 4 or 5 feet off the ground, you can't walk under the tree. You come back many years later, and the only way to correct that is with a chainsaw cutting off big branches that are in your way. So you can fix it all with just a pair of hand shears. And let me just comment, they're using hand shears. These are hand shears, and these are the Felcos. These are really nice. You can pay as much as $70 for a pair of these. There's a place up in Pasadena, the Lawnmower Corner on Walnut in Pasadena, that sells them for about $45. A good deal, because if you go to some of the more expensive nurseries, they can be as much as $70. Now, these are really nice. They make a nice cut. So you always want to have a pair of nice hand shears. And you want to try and do most of your pruning with a pair of hand shears. Now, the other thing you'll need is a pair of loppers. And here's a pair of loppers. And these are, you know, this is for making larger cuts. Don't try and cut something that's too big for the tool you're using. So you can cut about a 1 to 2 inch branch with a pair of loppers, with this particular pair of loppers. You can get some bigger loppers that'll cut a 3 inch branch. Your hand shears, you're cutting, you know, 1 inch branches or maybe a little smaller. Now another tip is when you're cutting the branch, if you're cutting like this on top of the branch, right at the crotch, you can split the branch. You want to cut it with the blade underneath the branch, and you won't damage the branch that way. Or you cut it sideways like this, but you don't want to have that sharp blade be on the top of the branch. So if you're cutting my finger off like this, then if you do it like that and you're cutting right up against the trunk, and here's the branch, and you got the blade on the top, it can split that, and I've seen it happen a lot. So it's not something that happens occasionally. It usually happens. So you want to flip your loppers over and have the blade underneath the branch when you're cutting off a branch, especially when you're doing your peach trees or when you're pruning like that. So you want to get quality tools. You know, don't try and save yourself a buck. I like to get really quality tools, and I like to get professional tools. Of course, I was a tree trimmer. I used to do a lot of tree work, not so much nowadays. Now, I want to continue on and just show you one more clip here on pruning apple trees and pruning pear trees. This is from an organic grower, organic individual who promotes organic gardening, and I have nothing against organic gardening. I'm more on the practical gardening side. If I have to use a broad spectrum material like an insecticide or a fungicide to control a specific pest, I'm willing to do that. I tend to go with all the soft pesticides, the organically registered pesticides, oils, soaps, and there's a whole list of them. I'll reach for those first. It's called integrated pest management. But that doesn't mean I exclude some of the products that I might need to use, but I'm pontificating, and now I need to move on. Let's take a look at our next clip, which is pruning apple trees and pruning pear trees. And it will repeat some of the things we've already talked about, but it talks a little bit more about establishing those tiers on your pears and apples. Let's take a look at this clip.
The fruit trees are dormant, so it's time to prune. Today, I'm going to prune this apple tree using the Central Leader Training System. There are three main fruit tree training systems. Open vase is wide and short. It takes up the most space, but it's the best for fruits like peaches and nectarines. Central Leader is tall and thin and takes up the least space. Fruits like dwarf apples, pears, apples, and Asian pears like this training system. Modified Central Leader is halfway between the two, and it's the best for persimmons, cherries, and apricots. Anything that likes Central Leader likes modified Central Leader too. Central Leader trees end up looking like a cone or like a Christmas tree. They have one upright trunk and whorls of scaffold branches coming off the leader. These trees may be taller, but they fit better in narrow spaces. Central Leader trees are not recommended for high wind areas or places where there's fire blight. To start, I'm going to pick the strongest upright shoot to be my leader, and then I'm going to prune any competing shoots. Next, I'm going to choose my permanent scaffold branches, and I'm going to label them with this ribbon. The first scaffold branches should come off the tree from about 18 to 24 inches from the ground. Look for branches that are coming off the trunk at a 45 to 60 degree angle. Branches that have an angle to the trunk of less than 45 degrees are often weak and will break under the load of fruit or snow. Each of the scaffolding branches should be in a different quadrant of the tree, and none should be right on top of the other. And you want about 8 to 10 inches between scaffolding branches. If you have a well-placed branch, but it comes off the trunk at less than 45 degrees, you can use a spreader to position it. I've chosen my scaffolding branches, so I'm going to prune the other branches with a thinning cut. Notice the collar that goes around the branch that's attached to the trunk. You want to make your cut as close to the collar as possible without cutting into the collar. You also don't want to cut too far out, because then you'll leave a stub. Now I'm going to head back the scaffolding branches to a nice outward facing bud. I'm going to leave little spurs like this because this likely will bear fruit. Head the tree back to about 20 inches from the highest scaffolding branch. Now that I've pruned the tree, I'm going to position the branches with spreaders. A simple way to spread little branches is with a clothespin. For bigger branches, you can use a burlap sling with a brick or a rock. Make a small burlap sling to avoid girdling the branch. Attach a piece of twine to your burlap sling. Get the desired angle of spread, and then tie it off to the brick or the rock. The end goal of a Central Leader tree is to have four tiers of four branches. The top scaffolds should be shorter than the bottom, and the tree should have a cone or pyramid shape. Pruning is easy if you plan ahead. So take care of your trees, train them, and grow organic for life.
I think she really explains that well. You know, the goal of a Central Leader system and ending up with three or four tiers of three to four branches each. The one thing I found interesting in her clip was she said that Central Leader doesn't work so good where you have fire blight. Fire blight is a bacterial disease of apples and pears and some other plants. It goes to pyracantha and some other members of the rose family. caused by a bacteria called Erwinia amylovera. And it is moved from tree to tree by bees. And it gets into the wood and causes a canker, and that canker bleeds and gums in the spring. And then bees are attracted to that when it's raining and it's gumming, and the tree flowers in the spring, and the bees come and get the bacteria on them, and they go get it into the flowers, and then it moves down the flower stem or the pedicel of the flower into the twigs and girdles that, and then you get flagging. And we see that quite frequently in our ornamental pears, our flowering pears that are quite common in California. And they're blooming right now around town. Big, you know, they're beautiful when they bloom. And you need to prune out any infected wood. And every time you prune out a branch for fire blight, you've got to clean your shears between every cut. Normally when you're pruning, cleaning your shears, it's between plants. Or if with orchids, if you're worried about viruses, you're cleaning your shears between plants, not every cut. With pears and apples, you should be cleaning your shears between every cut, especially if you're pruning out dead branches that were killed by fire blight, or Erwinia amylovera. But the funny thing she said was that the central leader doesn't work well where you have fire blight. But the reality is, wherever you grow pears and apples, you have fire blight. It occurs wherever they're grown. It's a huge problem, especially for commercial production, up north in Oregon and Washington, Northern California. And it is the number one disease. Well, you know, there's some other big problems too, but fire blight's a big, big problem. And they use a variety of ways to control it, primarily by pruning out infected wood during the winter. And as soon as you see any flagging, if you see a branch die in the canopy, you've got to go in and prune out that branch. You have to prune out about 12 inches below the dead wood. So what you'll do is you'll follow back the dead wood. It's dead to here. You go down another 12 inches and cut out that branch. You don't want to let it get into the trunk. That would be a disaster. It is only really bad in Southern California in really wet seasons. So this particularly dry winter will probably have almost no problem. Well, that's really all we have to talk about today. We talked about a lot about pruning trees. We'll be back next Sunday with another episode of Gardens of California. In the meantime, pray for rain. We need it. We need it desperately. We especially need it up in the Sierras, where we only have about 12% of snowpack. Save water. Kill your lawn. If you want to know how to kill your lawn, give me a call next week when we'll talk about more issues about your gardens in California. Until then, happy gardening. Thank you to the crew for helping put on the show, and have a nice day.
Now, last week we talked with Mr. Tim McGuire, and if you remember, he's the head athletic trainer at CSU Dominguez Hills, and he has a great responsibility to rehab the athletes when they have injuries in all the sports that we have here. And if you remember, he talked in great deal about how he did that, and we even talked about taping, and we talked about different types of supplements that they have to have for a quick recovery. And we talked about the motivation oftentimes that he has to have for his athletes, because once you have that particular injury, it takes a long time for some of those injuries to rehab themselves, and you have to go through a lot of work. And your mind kind of gets involved with all of that preparation and through the process. And so he does help a lot with motivation.